Hello, Pirate Nation. Welcome to another edition of Hall Talk. I'm Kevin Huebler. We've got a lot to talk about this week between the baseball and softball teams, but the week also saw more news break from the men's basketball team. The revolving door at the point guard position will continue to turn heading to next year, but the race for who will fill the shoes of Kadeem Carrington got shorter this week. It started with Aaron Gordon announcing via his Twitter page that he would be exploring his options to transfer on Monday. Gordon picked up the majority of the point guard minutes but at the backup role last season. Just 2 days later, it was revealed by Gannett, New Jersey's Jerry Carino that highly touted Jordan Walker would also transfer. Walker had a rough go of it in South Orange, injuring his thumb early in the season, then seeming to quit for a short period after not playing against Rutgers, and finally re-injuring that thumb, missing the postseason. We'll have to wait and see how this all shakes out for Kevin Willard, but for now, stick around because this is Hall Talk. Welcome back into this episode of Hall Talk. I'll introduce my panel now, JP Proulx, Matt Lamb. Guys, thanks for being here.
Oh, it's great to be here.
Always good.
So let's jump right into it here, guys. I mean, with the slew we talked about in the intro, in the open, the slew of men's basketball transfers, where does Kevin Willard go from here now only with really two guards that he can put in that point guard spot, and one being a two guard in Quincy McKnight?
Well, honestly, what they need to do is they need to look at a grad transfer right now for point guard, because Quincy McKnight is not a point guard at all. I've seen him play a couple times at Sacred Heart, and he's a two guard through and through. He can put points on the board, not a one. Anthony Nelson coming in is a one, but I don't know if you want to rely that on a freshman, so he needs to go find someone.
Yeah, you're looking at a lot of depth at the bigs, the four and five spots for this team, which you were lacking in the past. Now it's more of a flip-flop. You're lacking that depth at the guard position. So you're really, Miles Powell is also a two-guard who's going to be in that rotation. Don't see him playing point guard anytime soon. So really, like JP said, look for somebody on the grad transfer market or just try to develop somebody else.
Another thing coming out of the men's basketball news this week, the extension of that Garden State Hardwood Classic. What do you guys think of the extension that they put in for this, for the Rutgers-Seton Hall rivalry?
Well, number one, it's nice to keep playing Rutgers. I mean, there's really much more you can say to that. Let's get the trophy back home. I think it's wrong being up in Piscataway right now, but other than that, that's all we can say.
It's fitting. I mean, the two best Division I programs in the state are going to go at it till 2026 now. So, again, some close matchups, as always, intriguing games. And Steve Pickles really gotten that team of Rutgers, you know, really making them more competitive lately, too. So it's going to be great to see Seton Hall play them again.
So a lot to talk about here coming up for the men's basketball season, obviously going into next year, but we'll look at the two sports that are in season in baseball and softball. We'll start with baseball. They're coming in to this weekend. They head to Creighton on the road. That starts on Friday night in Omaha, but they're coming off of their best start in conference play since 1989. They've won their first three conference series for the first time since 1995. What did you guys think of the way this team has started conference season compared to what our expectations were coming into it?
Well, right now, this team's shooting out of a cannon right now. I mean, I thought they'd be fighting for fourth right now. I legitimately think they can finish second in this conference. And if they get a sweep this week, they're tied for first. So if they keep playing well, the sky's the limit. It's their best start since 89, where they're 13-1 in league play. That's insane.
And after two straight conference sweeps, this team is really rolling right now. And questions concerning injuries at the beginning of the year really did, you know, leave a lot of question marks at the pitching positions and, you know, in the fields, losing so many seniors. But again, this team's really taken it in stride, and they've really, you know, worked on those improvements all season, and it's all really coming into shape now.
Also, always helps when you have those backup guys in the bullpen that you can rely on if your starters get into trouble, like Rob Shepard's been able to do. But now they kind of turn to a point in the season where starts get a little bit tougher. They faced Villanova, they faced Xavier, two of the bottom teams in the Big East this year. Now they got Creighton, who's a perennial top-tier team in the Big East this year, having been off here. But then coming up next week, St. John's, the leader in the conference, just picking up their first loss last weekend. Where does this team go now heading to the tougher part of the Big East conference season with these top teams coming in?
Well, number one, you got to win. Just play the game in front of you. Right now, Creighton's traditionally a power in the Big East, but this year they're off. They're 4-7 in league play. They're in fifth place, so they can go and they can take that series. Georgetown just beat them 2-1 in Omaha, so it's doable. I know they have a strong home field advantage at TD Ameritrade Park, but I mean, it's doable. This team can do it.
Yeah, if there's any time for this Pirates team to do it, it's now, like you said. I mean, Creighton is always a very difficult opponent to play, but the way the Pirates are playing right now, the way
this is popped up,
combining
see if Toke has a play
the ball, it really
in foul territory,
possible series win,
and Creighton it's caught on deflection by Caputo.
Matchup next weekend, two great clubs going to go at it.
Was that Caputo?
So now we know how we'll get to Rob Dodon in a second here, but for this this Seton Hall baseball team and Rob Shepard's club, we know that pitching can sometimes be an issue at the front of the at the start of the games. We know the bullpen is solid. Who needs to step up for this team going into the tougher part of the season?
My guy is going to be Billy Lane Jr. And my reasoning is that he honestly was not tapped to be a weekend starter this year. He's supposed to be a weekday starter, but with the injury to Colin Dana, he's been called up to pitch on Sundays. If he can throw well, this team can win a ton of games. So is have him keep playing the level he is right now, and they'll keep continuing to win.
And he looked great on Sunday, too, in that win against Villanova. And having him and Ricky DeVito come out of the bullpen from last season, now into that starting rotation, it's really helped this team. And I'm going to continue to look at those relief pitchers this season for the Pirates. Matt Leon, Corey Sawyer, Noah Thompson, a few guys that come to mind that have really produced so far this season and then just wanted to continue to, you know, lock down the end of the game for this Pirates team. After you get some great work from the starting pitching, it's got to go the full nine innings.
Yeah, you bring up Leon picking up another save over the weekend in that series with Villanova. So now it's time, guys, we're going to jump into our buying or selling period or segment here on Hall Talk, where we kind of decide whether you guys are going to buy the, obviously buy this statement, or if you think it's a statement that obviously isn't going to work out too well for this baseball team. We'll start off this team's hot start to conference play. We mentioned it's the best start since 1989 when they went 13-1 to start the year. They're sitting at 8-1 in conference right now, three games back of St. John's. Do you buy or sell this team's hot start?
Buy. They have beaten the third best team in this conference and swept them in Indianapolis. That should be enough right there to tell you that they are legitimate and this isn't a fluke.
You have to buy this. You have to be, you know, remiss to not buy this statement. I mean, this team has played so well, and after having so many question marks this year, going into conference play, this is always a tough conference to play in the Big East, and they've certainly shown that they are worthy of being at the top so far.
I mentioned that we were going to talk about Rob Dodona. Here it is. Do you buy or sell his hot start? Hitting above 330, his career hitter, he never hit above 230 in his career. He's a 267 career hitter overall. Where do you see him going here? Do you buy or sell this where he's going?
Right. I'm going to have to buy again because he's putting contact on the ball every time he's at the plate. And if you get the ball on the field, it's more likely to be a hit. He's not striking out as much, and that right there is the reason why he's hitting about 350 right now.
I'm going to try and take the opposite here and sell this, but you can turn this into a buy if you have the other seniors on this team continue to produce it the way that they are. Michael Westio, Al Molina, Ryan Ramiz, some guys have come to mind in the middle of the lineup have been producing so well for this team so far, and if they can keep it going, then Dodona will feed off of that and they'll continue to go forward.
I'll have to wait and see how this team finishes up. Obviously, through the halfway point of the conference season now, they'll have three series remaining after this show. They have two series left after this weekend. Turn our attention now to softball, the other side of the diamond here at the Hall. Last week, they were swept by Villanova. Game one, 15-6. They were Reagan Camp had only went two innings. She's the best pitcher on this team. She allowed nine runs. Only four were earned. Where do you see this team at as they head into their final series this week when they go to Georgetown?
I mean, I don't know if there's much more we can say right now. Let's honestly, with them right now, I was trying to get some confidence going into next season because, I mean, they're out of the Big East tournament. Mm-hmm. So just get a couple wins, make yourself feel better, and there's somewhere to go for next season.
Yeah, they're currently 4-14 in conference right now. Haven't won a game since April 13th, so trying to just, you know, play that fundamental baseball. They have 89 team errors on the season compared to 36 for its points. So again, you want to just try and make sure you're getting glove on the ball and making that right play. And if you're able to do that, this team has shown the potential that they're able to get the bat on the ball and really play a complete game. You just need to make sure you do that in the field first.
Yeah, they really showed last week that holes in the defense can sometimes appear, especially with a young team in what Paige Smith has currently right now for this softball team. But they head into their final series this week when they go down to visit Georgetown. What are your predictions going into this final weekend of Big East play for the softball team?
I'm going to say they'll finally pick up a win just to get something going. And if it's on the last game of the season, that's even better because then that they end on a positive note instead of like going 13 losses in a row. That'd
always be, you know, icing on the cake, finish out the season strong. I mean, this Georgetown team is similar to Seton Hall in the sense that they're 14-35 and 5-12 in conference. So Seton Hall has the potential on paper to pick up this win. On the road, it's always a little bit tougher. But then if Reagan Camp pitches the way that she does at home and just has some, you know, run support behind her, Haley Arteaga has really been stepping up so far this season. Peyton Beaver, Alexis Walton doing what she does all the time. this team should be able to pick up at least one win in D.C.
So just about to wrap things up here for this final show, if we didn't tell you earlier, this is the final show of Hall Talk for the year. Three of us are seniors, so JP, I know you wanted to say something to the loyal viewers of Hall Talk.
All right, guys. It's been a pleasure being on your camera for 2-3 years now. It's great. I got a couple people I'd like to thank. I thank Luis Olvera. I'd like to thank Vinny Paola. Just guys like that, Aaron Ross, all these people. Gave us a chance to get to learn, and having that has done a great job. And also everyone that I'm currently with, you two, of course, Anwar, EP. It's just, it's been a great time here at Hall Talk, and I'm honestly going to miss it.
So now, Matt, let's hear what you, your final thoughts as we get set to wrap things up here on Hall Talk.
Well, Pirate Television, it's been real, it's been fun, but most of all, it's been really fun. I really enjoyed this time here on Hall Talk and Pirate Television as a whole. Pirate News, being a producer for that, has also been a great time, great to come into very hands-on environment and really work your way, to what we are now, seniors who really do lead this station, and it's been a really great time and gonna miss it.
You mentioned missing it. It's obviously gonna be something that I'm going to miss here being a senior as well. I really did enjoy the fact that Lauren O'Connor, Emily Mastroboyana gave me the opportunity, I know they did it for you, Matt, as well, our freshman year, to be able to step in and help out with Hall Talk and be able to get on camera. But we've also had a little bit of fun here at Hall Talk, which means it's time now. We're going to show you here some bloopers that we've had, some outtakes that you haven't seen before. Here is our 2018 spring semester blooper reel.
Blooper reel. Pirate TV.
Across the court,
That was really good.
New Jamaican eatery is now heading.
Go start from the top.
Yep.
Thanks, Chris. I'm Jillian Yarzenbu.
Even you can't pronounce your own name.
You know I don't know what I'm saying.
Pirate TV will be doing a bouncing trunks at 3 o'clock in the morning on that day, so it'll be very interesting. And Seton Hall's bouncing trunks will be at 3 o'clock in the morning on that day. Come out. And our very own Pirate. All right, I'm not gonna say it.
Pitch treasurer Javita Carzana is set to deliver the keynote address at Seton Hall's baccalaureate. What is that word?
Baccalaureate.
No, like everyone just said a different thing.
No,
what is it?
Baccalaureate. I believe.
Holy wow.
Tomorrow will be rainy with a high of 57 and a low of 48 on Thursday. There will be partly cloudy skies with a high of 62 and a low. Let's redo that.
Hello, Pirate Nation.
I'm gonna quit.
I'm not wearing waterproof mascara, so I'm concerned.
No help, Tommy.
What's up, Pirate fans? Welcome to this week's episode. That's the wrong way.
Me and Ness, who all tied fourth overall, and this led to, wait, what? Sorry, I just got confused from my own reading.
I'm
not interrupting you anymore. Is there okay to talk now?
What?
No.
Oh. Okay, I just wanted to say thank you guys so much. I have to go. I want to say hello to all the seniors. The best luck possible. It's been great working with you. I enjoy being part of your final broadcast here. I hope you remember me and your experience here really well.
Oh, we'll remember this.
So this year behind us here is now finally the crew that makes all of this possible for us to be here on camera for JP, for Matt, for everybody here at Pirate TV. Thanks for watching all season long. Make sure you tune in next year for another season of Hall Talk. This is Hall Talk.
There you go.